Evelyn David. I'm a member of the staff at MediaX Interactive Technologies. We have a guest with us this afternoon, Professor Benjamin Wright from the University of Chicago. And he's here to tell us something about Microscale, which is a program he has authored with Michael Lineker, also of MediaX. He's going to tell us what this program does, and he's also going to tell us something about measurement. For those of us who are not involved in measurement every day, it'd be helpful to be refreshed.
All right. Thank you, Evelyn. Well, I'm presuming that you wouldn't be watching us if you weren't interested in measurement. And the first thing I'm going to do is to argue with Evelyn, because I would contend that we do measurement every day. In fact, it's one of the basic activities we do in order to think, and that therefore what we're going to talk about is something that everybody knows a lot about, although they may not know how much they know about it. Let's begin by thinking about the word measurement and what we imply when we use such a word. We're talking about identifying something in the situation which repeats itself, some similarity, some trend, some direction, some issue, like height or weight or intelligence or beauty or love of country or attractiveness of some food or some such thing. And when we start thinking about something like that, we are meaning that we have experienced several examples of what is for us more of the same kind of thing. And in that case, we're interested in comparing these examples. So the first element in the idea of measurement is the making of a, is first the identity of a similarity, and then the making of a comparison, or if you like, a choice between two things. In order to choose between them, we have to decide which is more. So the third element is the judgment of more or less. As soon as we do that and say this is more than that, this apple is more attractive than that apple, or this person is more favorable to the Democratic Party than that person is, or this person is better at mathematics than that person is, or this question, this mathematics question is harder than that mathematics question is. As soon as we reach that stage in our thinking, the next natural question we ask is, how much more? And that's the measurement question. The question of how much more indicates that we are now thinking along some line of inquiry, which goes from very little to very much, or from less to more. We're imagining the possibility of positioning the mathematics questions or the mathematics scholars along this line, depending on how much they have of mathematics. And we're expecting to define the nature of the line, to understand what the line tells us about, by seeing where the mathematics questions fall along it and what they tell us about how much mathematics you know when you're at a certain place on the line. So those are the basic ingredients of thoughts about measurement.
Okay, now, we can use that. You've talked about that in terms of language we use every day. When I look at your textbook, I see other words, and I want to link them up with what you've been telling me.
You're referring to either best test design or rating scale analysis.
Yes, all right. Now, you talk in terms of variable as that line you're trying to identify.
Yes.
And then you're also talking about positioning objects on the line.
Yes.
All right, now how do you do that?
Well, in a way, we do it all the time when you go shopping. You decide which object you like more than another, and you buy the one that you like more, and you decide how much to pay for it by how much it's worth to you. So the kinds of quantitative decisions which go into a measurement result are being conducted by you all the time in order to make judgments about everything you do. However, you can make this more automatic and more objective and more systematic if you address the problem directly and ask yourself, what kinds of relationships would I want to have between the possibilities I'm considering in order to be able to decide among them in a quantitative way? And it helps a lot now to go to a simple but I think familiar to everyone situation. Let's suppose a teacher in a classroom is teaching arithmetic, and she is explaining various operations in arithmetic to her students, and then in order to find out whether she's successful, she asks them questions about arithmetic. And she learns how much they have learned from her
by how well they answer her questions. Some questions she asks are easy and some hard. Some students answer many of them correctly, some answer only a few correctly. And in this situation, she is, all of us are used to getting our tests scored and finding out who knows the most arithmetic and who knows the next most. All of us can be ordered on our score on the test. We may not have thought about it, but at the same time that the test, that our responses to the questions on the test are putting us in an order from the person who knows the most about arithmetic on this test to the person who knows the least, our behavior is also arranging the items from the item that's the easiest for us to know to the item that's the hardest for us to know. So when the teacher gets back this collection of answers from each student, an answer to each of her questions, she has a kind of a rectangle of information where every time a student takes an item, we have an answer which is either right or wrong. And that tells her about the arrangement of the children and the arrangement of the items. But it also tells her something else, because she can use that information if the items conformed with the students to a single line of inquiry. She can use it to actually define the line, attach the items to it, and position the children on it so that the distances between them will have a uniform meaning. So that if John is here and Fred is here and Jane is twice as far away up here, then she can say that Jane is twice as far from Fred as John is. That is, there can actually be some units developed along the line which allow her not only to say who is more, but how much more. And it's that how much more which makes it measurement. Before that, it's just ordering.
Mm-hmm.
But measurement requires ordering, but ordering doesn't always produce measurement. However, people are routinely conducting themselves as though measurement were possible. Every time a teacher scores a test, she is acting as though measurement were possible with that test. And what my books are about and what the new MediaX microcomputer program Microscale does is to take the kind of data, information that teachers can collect in classrooms or that researchers can collect in research studies or that anybody can collect in any situation that they're trying to understand better. It takes this data and tries to make measures out of it. If it succeeds, it's because the data will cooperate with that effort, and the program will then tell you about the dimension that you have constructed and where the children fall in that dimension. If the data won't cooperate with that intention, then the program, Microscale, tells you where the trouble is, which items are not working to produce information about the same kind of thing as the rest of the items. It might be that you have some word problems in your arithmetic test and that they have hard words, hard reading words, and that in fact those items are more reading items than arithmetic items. That is, the arithmetic operation may be simple, but the way the operation is described in the word problem may be difficult for some of the children to read. So you've inadvertently produced some items which are reading test items as well as arithmetic items.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Microscale will tell you if those items are producing different kind of behavior from the children than the others. It will tell you about that, and it will point to those items so that you can consider how you want to modify them to produce the result that you would like to have. The same thing happens with a child. If a child, for some reason or other, is upset about subtraction, they can do addition, they can do multiplication, but perhaps the connotation of subtraction as takeaway may upset them. So when they come to a subtraction problem, they freeze and they can't perform as well as you would think they should be able to from their addition performance or their multiplication performance. Microscale will indicate that child for you, tell you which problems he's having unexpected difficulty with, so that you can then address his particular relationship to the material individually.
Okay, so what Microscale does is suggest an ability for each, given ability for each student.
It extracts from the data a measure of each student's ability.
And then, if his performance on an item does not meet that expectation,
it tells you which item, which student, and which item, so that you can diagnose the situation and help the child.
Well, I have some examples of classroom tests.
Do you? Let's take a look.
Do you think you could look at them?
Sure.
All right.
No. I should say, while you're getting them out, that the Microscale does three things. You give it some children taking some test items or some situations being dealt with in some ways. And what's observed is how the child does on the item, or what happens when the situation is dealt with in a particular way. What MicroScale does with that is it gives you a measure for each child, it gives you a calibration for each item, and it gives you what's left over that doesn't fit with the measure for the child and the calibration for the item.
Now, the matrix that you were talking about, we've produced for a group of eighth grade children. These children, there are 19 children in the class, there are 10 girls and 9 boys. They're being tested on 20 items, and the topic of the test, the name of the test is the police in our society. Mm-hmm. Now, what's the variable on there?
All right, let's take a look. Let me have this first, because you should see what we have here. This is a typical data matrix. Here we have, in this case, which are the rows and which are the columns?
Okay.
Now, this is the student going down here, and here are the items on the test.
Now, let me say that I put this into the computer.
Yeah.
What I did was to take a grid of paper and take the test scores right off the classroom test, put them on a matrix like this, and then key it into the computer. I didn't key it in the way you see it here. After I summed all the student scores and summed the item scores, then I had the MicroScale program arrange the scores in descending order so that the students who were most able appear up in this column and the items that have that are the easiest to do are up also in this column. Now, what does that tell us now about items?
All right, I think this is good. We're going to talk a little bit more about this matrix, because once we understand what this matrix contains, we'll see the rest of the story very easily. Measurement measurement always concerns a matrix of this kind, and MicroScale always deals with a matrix of this kind. The matrix always has the property that there are rows defined, in this case, by children, or they could be some other objects that you're interested in measuring. They could be cities, they could be departments, they could be schools, or they could be times of day, they could be intersections in a road system. The other dimension, if these are the children or the objects of measurement, the other dimension then should be the agents of measurement. In this case, the questions in the test. And every row is a different agent of measurement. And in the intersection between a row and a column is what we observe happened when we gave that agent to that object, to that question, to that child. And in this case, if the child got the question right, we put a 1 in. If the child got the question wrong, we put a 0. Now, it could be that what occurred at this point was some kind of performance, and that the performance were graded from 0 to 5. Or it could be that we counted the seconds it took to complete a task.
So it could be 99.
Well, it could be
any
count can go in here.
Okay.
It has to be a count of something that's definable, a definable event. It could be the number of baskets made on 10 tries. Or it could be the seconds taken to put together a toy or a piece of machinery. Mm-hmm. Or it could be the number of mistakes made when reading a paragraph, a passage mm-hmm. of text.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, it's whether the child got the question right or not. Now, as Evelyn said, when she put it in, it wasn't arranged in this nice way. But you will see when you look closely that this has been arranged so that the smartest child with the highest score, those children are at the top. And the least knowledgeable children are at the bottom with the lowest score. And the easiest items, the items everybody got right, are on the left-hand side, and the hardest items, that only in this case 10 out of the 19 got right, on the right-hand side. We've ordered this matrix from easy to hard items, and from more able to less able children. And the picture we now see is the hallmark of a situation where measurement can be constructed. We see that there are lots of ones up here. The able children are getting the easy items correct. We see lots of zeros down here. The unable children are getting the hard items wrong. If we're going to succeed in building a variable, it must be that most of the zeros are in this region, and most of the ones are in this region, and there are only a few ones and zeros out of place, and they should kind of trickle along down this diagonal from the easiest item and the most able child, which should be almost all ones, down here to the least able child and the hardest item where we have mostly zeros. This pattern is very important. Here the pattern is violated in a few places. We see a wrong answer up here in the middle of the ones, and here's the pattern is violated down here. We see some ones among the zeros. Now the question will be, when we make the analysis, microscale will tell us how serious these violations are. Mm-hmm. And it will suggest to us what we might do to deal with those violations. If we are determined to extract from these questions a single variable of knowledge of, is this knowledge of the police? Is that what this is?
Police in our society, yes. It would be knowledge.
Knowledge about the police in our society. And we find a question like question 20 here, which seems to be answered about as frequently right by people who score low on the test as by children who score high. We might question whether that item belongs in the set with the rest. It may be a different kind of question, and we're going to have to look at that and see. Mm-hmm. In that case, if we're determined to have a single score to represent each child's knowledge of the police in our society, we're going to have to take that item aside. Mm-hmm. And maybe if it's an important issue, we may have to have other items like it and make a second test to measure another aspect of knowledge about this.
All right, let me tell you why we're using this test. In our school system, we're building a curriculum, social studies curriculum, and we're trying out different textbooks. Textbooks have different kinds of tests. And we also don't know very much about, we don't have a lot of information about how children learn social studies in the same way that we know how children learn reading and so forth. So we're interested in what information microscale can give us about the test and about the children taking the test.
All right, good. This reminds me of something you said at the beginning. You said we produced this matrix. That's not true. The children produced this matrix.
Okay.
We produced, if we're the teachers, we produced the questions.
All right.
Then the children produced the answers. And now the question is, question is getting used a couple of ways here, but now our question is, is the way the children used our test questions, does that tell us how they learned about the police in our society? Now you might say, well, how will it tell us that? Well, it should tell us that the easiest question was the one that was easiest to learn, and the next hardest question was the next hardest to learn, and that the hardest questions were the ones that took the longest to learn or the hardest to grasp. And that ordering of questions from easy to know, because now you see how well it's known, too hard to know, because you see how poorly it's known, that should tell us the hierarchy of the subject matter involved with this topic, police in our society. So if the children will, in their behavior, order the items from easy to hard, then they are telling us by their behavior what the order of that subject matter is in their learning. They tell us which things are easy to learn and which things are hard to learn.
Okay.
And in a way, this may be which things we should teach first and which things we should teach second. Now, it isn't always the case, but very frequently, the ordering of the items, almost all the time, the ordering of the items matches the ordering of the curriculum, the learning order of mm-hmm. the curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
It's very seldom the case that something to be taught first is, in fact, learned last. That doesn't make sense. So under ordinary circumstances, what's taught first is what's learned first, and that which means learned easiest. And what's taught last is what's learned last.
Okay. Now I'm really curious about the answers.
The answers?
Yes.
So these go ahead.
Right. Well, the answers are the information that's given by microscale.
Well, do we have a microscale analysis of these data?
Well, we do. It's right on the other side.
All right. Here it is over here. Okay. Now,
By the way, it only took, 30 seconds to run that program.
Yeah.
Not long at all. Now, do you need some interpretation there?
In order to do justice, now, this gives us the numbers, and of course, numbers make statisticians very happy, but they don't make teachers very happy. What we would like to have eventually in this segment of this story would be a picture of this situation. We've got numbers here, Now, our first job is to figure out what the word measurement refers to. And I'm going to do it in terms of pictures, because that's easier sometimes to grasp than a string of more words. If we imagine what we want to know about as a line going from less to more, we could call that a variable. That's a picture of a variable. Now, if a person is down here on that line, they haven't got very much of it yet. And if they're up here, they've got a lot. And this person is more than that person. And how much more is the distance from here to here? But arrows like that, that's an invention of our mind. It's something we've imagined. And whether it's going to be useful to us or not depends whether we can attach it to some events, some realities, some facts that we have collected. Now, if we give, I'm going to draw a little thing down here. If we give some children, they go down here, every row is a child, some items that go across here, so that here in the middle of this thing is one child taking a particular item, producing a response of some kind right at that point. We give a set of questions or items to a group of children, collect all their answers into this rectangle of data. What the children do there, that's a fact. We have set the fact up, but the children have produced the results. Now, we can take this information and try to construct a line from it. And if it succeeds, if we succeed when we try to do that, we'll find that this line is explained by where the items are on it. We'll be able to position each of our questions somewhere along the line, and these positions will tell us what the line is. If it's an arithmetic test, this may be addition here, this may be subtraction, that may be multiplication, this may be division or some such thing like that. If we can explain the line by attaching our questions to it, then we can position the children on top of this line according to how much arithmetic they know. And we will have taken this interaction between children and items and turned it into a variable explained by the items and measuring the children. These are the measures. A child's measure is where he is on the line. These are the calibrations down here. They're the explanation or definition of the line in terms of the questions being asked. Now, we're talking about microscale. It's a computer program for an IBM PC, and microscale takes this and makes that, and then it tells you how well it does it. Now, you might say to yourself, well, how does it do that? And that's where the psychometrics comes in. That's where the definition of measurement comes in. That's where what's sometimes called the measurement model comes in. That's our next picture. But when we go to the next picture, remember what we're trying to do now. We can ask children questions. We know how to do that. We can collect their answers. We can say when we do this that we intend to score the children on the questions and by their score arrange them from those who know the most to those who know the least. We can look at the items and arrange them from the easiest to the hardest. Can we use this information to build a line defined by items on which the children are positioned according to how much they know? And that where this line then is the dimension, and these positions are the measurements of the children.
Could you go back to calibrations again?
Well, every item gets a measure too. But since the item is an agent of inquiry, it's the vehicle of what we think we're doing here. If we're asking arithmetic questions, then this is an arithmetic variable. And it's made an arithmetic variable by virtue of the fact that its questions or items are arithmetic items. If these were spelling questions, this would be a spelling variable. And if these were attitudes towards God, this would be a variable of how much you believed in God.
Okay, but the calibration, I need to understand this better. I always thought was marking off the line in equal units.
Ah, the calibration is positioning the items on a line which is itself marked off in equal units.
Okay.
The items themselves are not equally spaced necessarily, but they define a line which is itself measured in equal units. In fact, that's what a line is.
So the calibration.
You can't have a line not in equal units.
So you'll have calibration figures.
Yeah, there'll be numbers here. This might be at 1.6, this might be 1.8, that might be 2.1, and so on. Whatever value the item gets will say where it is on the line. And then whatever measure the child gets will say where the child is on the line. And as a matter of fact, if there's a child right here, his position on the line tells you this. If he's here, he can do these things, and he can't do those things. So in every position along the line, there is a diagnosis of that child's knowledge, making explicit what he has mastered and what he has not mastered. Now, we can be even more detailed about that, because if the child is right here, then he has a 50% chance of succeeding on these items right here. An item back about one unit, he has a 75% chance of succeeding on. An item back two units, he has a 90% chance of succeeding on. So we can detail his mastery level in terms of all the materials by which we've defined the item, telling which things he has 50% mastery of, which things he has 75% mastery of, which things he has 90% mastery of, and any percent in between that interests us. Up here we have 25% mastery, 10% mastery. So what does this mean for the teacher when she looks at the mastery profile of a particular child at a particular position in the item? It means that she can tell what to start teaching him, perhaps those things that are 30 or 40% mastery. What not to bother him with, the stuff that's too hard, he only has 5% mastery of it. What to review him on, maybe the stuff that he has 60 or 70% mastery of. What to be satisfied he's completed, the stuff that he's got 90% mastery on. So she gets a detailed prescription of her teaching plan for each child based on his position on the line, which is defined by the items being the curriculum of this topic. That makes sense?
That makes sense.
All right. Now let's look at the mathematics. Let's look at the mathematical formula that Microscale uses on these data to construct this line. We'll draw the line at the top of the page again to so we remember what we're trying to do. And here is a person. We'll give his measure as B. B is a value, some value like 14 or 73 or something like that. And here is an item, D. That's where the item is. Now this person is more able, because he's up on this side, than this item is difficult. And this distance right here is the advantage that that person has on that item. The bigger this difference, the further the person is above the item, the better they have mastered it. Now if, in fact, there was another item, let's call this D1. Here's an item up here, D2. In this case, the person, this difference, B minus D2, that's going to be negative because D2 is bigger than B. So this child doesn't have a very good mastery of this material. The probability of his succeeding on this item is going to be maybe only 20%. But this item here that he's above, his probability will be greater than a half. It'll be more like 75 or 80% on this item. So let's consider just one of these. This difference between any one of them, let's take that one. The difference between the child's position, measure, and the item's calibration, or difficulty. We would like that to tell us the probability that the child will succeed. I'll make that phrase better than, or does better than, the item. In other words, we have a difference here. We want that difference to tell us how probable it is that this child, with that measure, will do better than, get right, solve correctly, that item. And the formula which does that is the following. We just say B minus D equals the logarithm of the probability that the child will get let's call this like this, get the item correct, over 1 minus the probability that the child will get the item correct. So we say that this difference is supposed to produce a special function of the probability of success for this child and this item. And the special function has a special form which makes this possible. And that special form, and there's only one form that does this job properly, is this right here, a logarithm like the one you learned about in high school algebra. Probability of success, 1 minus probability of success, which is the probability of failure. So this is the log odds. These are odds, see? Probability of success over probability of failure is the odds for a right answer. Log odds. So these are sometimes called logits. Log odds units. Log odds units, kind of buried in there. This is a logit model. Log odds, logit model, for the difference between the child's measure and the item's difficulty. Now, if you solve this equation for this value right here, it turns out to be like this. Now, we have to undo this log, and for that we use something called the exponential function, which is sometimes written like this. And I'll explain about that in just a moment. Or you could call, instead of exp, you could write it in the old form, some constant which is called E to the exponent B minus D over the same thing plus 1. All right, excuse me for writing so slanted like that. Now, I just solved this equation by ordinary college algebra. It's not calculus or anything else. E is a constant invented by a Scotsman who was trying to make the writing of logarithm tables simple for himself. Its value is about 2.71828. Any constant will work here. This is a very convenient one to choose, and there is a whole system of natural logarithms going back and forth between the log to this base and then the exponents of this base. And that's why there's a connection between this type of log and that choice of the base for which the exponent to which the exponent is applied. But you could write this model like this. The probability that the child is better than the item equals any number to the difference over 1 plus. And it'll also work. It doesn't matter what the number is. The only reason we choose this particular number is because our mathematical tables are set up to use it, and it makes it very convenient for us to do it. It's like choosing inches to measure things rather than some other unit that we're not familiar with or don't have rulers marked out in. Now, this model right here, that's the so-called response model. Probability of a successful response is e to the power b minus d plus over 1 plus e to the power b minus d, or sometimes spoken of as the exponential function of the difference between the child's measure and the item's difficulty over 1 plus the exponential function of the same difference. That is known as the Roche model, because it was first developed by a Danish mathematician in the 1950s who was trying to construct measures, trying to construct lines like this. And he analyzed the logical and mathematical necessities for producing such a line from such a piece of data. And he deduced that the function, the response function, has to be this one, or you can't construct the line. Therefore, this is not an arbitrary choice, but it is the logical consequence of saying, I want to make a line on which children are placed somewheres, items are placed somewheres, the items define the line, the children get measured by it, and the data I observe is whether a child gets an item right or wrong. If that's my data and that's my intention, then this has to be the response function. And this is the recipe or mathematical formula or measurement model that microscale works with. Now, microscale does better than that because it generalizes on this model, and it allows us, I'm going to go over another page here, it allows us not only to collect responses where you have a zero for a wrong answer and a one for a right answer, a so-called dichotomous or right-wrong response, but it could be that we have observed something like this. This is all wrong, let's say. This is a little right. This is more right, and this is all right. If we have a defensible definition of the possible things we can watch the child do, which divides into four ordered possibilities, we can then represent those four ordered possibilities with these numbers, 0, 1, 2, 3, and we can then get a difficulty for each step in this structure. So this particular question has three difficulties. The difficulty of going from 0 to 1, the difficulty of going from 1 to 2, the difficulty of going from 2 to 3. If all the questions share the same response structure as they would in an attitude scale, where this might be disagree a lot, disagree, agree, agree a lot, or never, sometimes, usually, always, then we might want the same spacing for all of the items. On the other hand, a microscale will also get these difficulties separately for each individual item. So while it builds on Roche's basic discovery, this is also Roche's model, with any base right here. Microscale builds on Roche's model, but it generalizes to the situation where the observation is not just a dichotomy with two categories, good, bad, right, wrong, yes, no, but with as many ordered categories as are natural to the situation in which the children are responding to the question. And it allows you to estimate characteristics for the item for every one of the steps that you have. And when you score a child, you count the number of steps he has passed. If he has gotten here, he has passed two of these steps and he gets a score of 2 from this item. If he's gotten here, he gets a score of 3. If he only gets here, he gets a score of 1. These numbers are the counts of the number of steps the child has successfully taken. And here, of course, is only one step. If he gets it right, he's successfully taken that one step. If it's wrong, he hasn't. And then as you go down over the items, here are the children. As you go across over the items, here are the items. As you go across here, you are counting the steps the child takes from each item, and his total score on the test, which you're all familiar with, is the count of the right answers, or in this more general language, the count of the correct steps taken, or the steps forward taken. And that score is the number from which we get his position on the line. And we also score down this way to find out how many steps were successfully taken for each item. And that item score takes us to the difficulty of the item. And if the item has several steps, then we get several difficulties, one for each of the steps in the item. So that's what microscale does in a nutshell.
Well, you've been talking about measures and items and persons and so forth, and I'm very familiar with that because I give tests and I take tests and so on. But now you've been talking also about measurement models, and when I think of a measure, I really don't know what you mean when you use the word measurement model.
Yeah. Well, it's a good question, and it's a subtle one, because it's one of those things where it's so obvious we don't notice it, and it's so abstract that we don't understand it. It's both of those things mixed together. You might ask yourself, why is it that we sell apples by the pound instead of by the apple? And the answer would be that apples are not all the same size. And so that if you really want to get a good equity in commerce with apples, you have to find a method for measuring them, which is uniform in some sense, in spite of the fact that the apples are different sizes. So in fact, produce was originally bought and sold by count.
Okay,
but later on by volume or weight. And volume and weight are both measures and require measurement models to produce them. Whereas counting isn't, you can see how many apples there are, but you can't see how much they weigh. You have to do something to them.
When I look at the scale, I don't think of that it's a model. What you're saying is the model produces the scale.
The scale is a realization of a measurement model. It has been calibrated with little lines on it, which tell you how many pounds the apples weigh.
And there's an inspector who comes around to the supermarket
checks,
and calibrates it.
Checks the calibration and makes sure it's correct and matches everybody else's scale. So all the scales are calibrated on the same imaginary variable,
which only exists
in our minds. In this case, it's pounds.
All right. What is the measurement model in this case?
Well, what the measurement model does in the case of weighing an apple, it translates the pressure of the apple on the spring of the scale into a position of a needle on a dial. And so in this case, the measurement model is the physical action, is the physical design of the scale, which transforms pressure into length, because the needle moves along, you see. The needle marks out the length of a line. Even if the line is curved, if the dial is a curved dial, that's just because the needle is hinged in the middle and has to move this way. But some scales move lengthwise, you know. The balance scale that you stand on at the gym, you move the weights along, you see. And the length of the scale tells you not how tall you are, but how heavy you are. The further the weights move along, the heavier you are. So what the scale does is translate the pressure of your body on the platform below into an indication on a line of where you stand. And the items on the line are the little markings along there, which is 1 pound, 2 pounds, 100 pounds, 200 pounds. Those are the items. And what you're finding out is how many of these items you pass and how many you fail. And your weight is just above the last one you pass and just below the first one you fail.
I can understand what my weight is. And I can understand that the pressure causes.
But you see, it took us a long time to figure out how to do that.
You see, I'm looking for something concrete when you talk about a measurement model.
Yeah.
Is it the design of the machine?
The design of the machine is based on an understanding of the nature of weight and how to ask questions about it. You see, the scale asks questions of the body being weighed as to what its weight is.
You know, at the moment, your description of a measurement model for our physical object sounds more complex than the measurement model you just described.
Well, there is something to be said for that. See, we all take for granted measurements of length and weight and time, the passage of time. We've forgotten that it's only 100 years or so since everybody, every locale had its own measure of time. And in fact, for a long time, up until about the 17th or 18th century, people tried to make 12 hours go between sunset and sunrise, no matter what time of year it was, which meant the length of the hour changed every day. So even something as simple as the measurement of time on a uniform scale is fairly recent. But we all take it for granted now as though, well, a minute was always a minute, and a minute is the same all over the world, but it was only recent. It's only in the last couple hundred years that that's been true, that we've reached an agreement about how long a minute is that we can sustain from place to place.
Let's move to another kind of measure.
Yeah.
The standardized tests that all of us have taken through school.
Yeah, they do not, they are not legitimate measures.
Well,
they are just orders.
But do they have a model? That's what I'm
saying. No, there's
about.
No measurement model being used explicitly, and that's why the results are not measures. They're just orders. They're rankings. It doesn't, going from, on the SAT, going from 500 to 600 does not mean the same thing as going from 600 to 700. Going from 580 to 590 does not mean the same thing as going from 590 to 600. In other words, 10 steps on the SAT scale does not mean the same thing from one end of the scale to the other.
All right. Let's get to the idea of objectivity.
And something else missing in the SAT scale is the positioning of the items along it, so you know if you have a 600, so you know what you can do. You see, when you measure your height, you know what it is in inches, and so you know what you can then think about what inches mean. But when you get an SAT report, you get the number 500. What does that mean? What can you do if you have a 500? What problems can you answer? You don't know. All you know is, if it's been normed, that you're about, you know about as much as the average person who was in the sample that was used when it was normed. But whether that sample applies to you or not, you don't know. Why should it? And you don't know what it means in terms of the activity and that the items supposedly interrogated. So the standardized scores reported by ETS, for example, are almost useless as measures.
What they simply are doing is ranking us.
They're just ranking the scores. They take the raw scores, they count the number of right answers, and they order the people by raw score on a new scale organized to produce a mean at 500, a mean of some sample, which they will then nominate as the sample, and a standard deviation of 100. And they may use the idea that people are normally distributed to give the scale a certain structure.
What?
But none of those acts have anything to do with measurement in the ordinary sense, in the physical science sense, in the mathematical sense, or the logical sense.
Okay. When we first talked about measurement, you drew a picture of a line.
Mm-hmm. The SATs are
the
not
logits.
On a, what's missing on the SAT line is the spacing. We don't know what the
there
spacing
no
is. The logits we know are uniformly spaced.
On the RASH model.
On any analysis based on that kind of a formulation. Now, we call that the Roche model because he's the first person who focused attention on that formulation and said that's the only one you can use. He was the first person to use it exclusively and to recognize its significance. Actually, there is other work which leads in the same direction, but it didn't really come to a clear focus until he did his work and his work became known.
Now, when we talk about weighing the apples, the variable is weight.
Yes.
And the apple is positioned on the line.
Yes.
And its pounds or its weight is.
Well, no. Let's back off that example. I was trying to think of the history of measurement in the commerce of mankind. And we know that measuring began in commerce when we're trying to exchange things, and that first of all people counted things and they traded things by count. But then they discovered that if you had 10 small apples, that wasn't as many apples as 10 big apples. So they thought of other devices for producing equity in their transactions, and volume and weight are the two that have emerged, and almost all things are sold by volume or weight.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays. And in fact, on cereal packages,
which are sold by weight, they give you a little message saying, don't expect the package to be full because this is sold by weight, not volume. In other words, they are aware of the fact that you may want the package to be full and hence mistake which currency is being used to give you your money's worth. They're selling you a certain amount of cereal based on the weight of the cereal, not on the volume. Now, the reason I mention those things is to show that the variables by which we transact business are really quite abstract. And in fact, so abstract, they have to be explained to the consumer in order for him to be content with it. But that we have moved to that position because anybody who thinks about it will not accept 10 little apples for 10 big ones. So we have to find another way of exchanging them, which makes it fairer. And that's because when you count the apples, what you count is specific to the apples you're counting. But when you just do the transaction, you'd like a currency which is general, and so will be fair now and tomorrow and the next day. So you need something which will transcend the specificity of the apples. Now let's turn to our school test, because that will help us to understand this. Suppose I have a 10-item test that I give the children. And some people get an 8, some get a 9, and some get a 7. And I expect that the 8's no more than the 7's, and so on and so forth. Now suppose some kids didn't come that day, and I got to get a measure on them too. But I can't give them the same questions because the first group will tell them about it. So I have another 10-item test, and suppose on the first test you get a 7, and on the second test I get an 8. So the teacher says, well, Ben, I guess you're better than Evelyn is on this. And you say, hey, wait a minute. In my test there were lots of multiplications and divisions, and in his test nothing but subtraction and addition. So his 8 is not worth more than my 7. What you're saying is that there's a specificity in the test itself which is not captured by the score. We must adjust the score for how difficult the test is before we can compare your score to mine. Now, you're not saying it's a different, you're not saying it's measuring a different thing. You're not saying that was a spelling test you took. You're willing to accept that they're both arithmetic tests. But you're saying, but they're not equated for difficulty. And so it's not fair to compare the two scores. And the equation for difficulty is what the measurement model is needed for. You must rise above the details of the data and try to construct a generalization which will transcend the specificities and develop a system for you. If all the items you might use can be put on the same line, then any test drawn from some of those items, the score for all the scores for that test can also be put on the line. And then you and I can be compared even though we took completely different tests. Even though there are no items in common, if the line is in common, your score on your test can be compared to my score on my test, and you and I can be brought to agree that whatever the positioning is, that it's a fair one. So it's this, that's the objectivity too, because the measurement model does is makes it possible to generalize what we believe is contained in the test. So instead of having the specifics of these 10 items and these 14 people who took the test, we have a general variable of math ability defined by these and other math items taken by these and other children, all of whom can be located on one line, which is the math ability line. Each item underpinning the line and explaining its meaning, its nature, from easy to hard, from beginning to end, from early in the curriculum to late, giving the curriculum of mathematics, of that part of mathematics, and the explanation of positions. And each child is positioned by his score on whatever items he took. Now, if you took an easy test and did very well, it doesn't put you very far up on the line. If you take a very hard test and do poorly, it may put you further along. A score of 2 on a hard test may mean more than a score of 8 on an easy test.
I can understand that. That makes sense to me.
But in order to say that, you have to have the arrow, the line. In order to have the line, you have to use a measurement model. And what the measurement model does is it separates the person scores and the item difficult and the item scores, the person measures and the item difficulties. So each one becomes independent, independently defined, but on the same line. And that allows you then to find other items and other persons and make new observations and put them all together into one single accounting system. And as a matter of fact, that's what you always think you're doing.
That's what I always thought I was.
Yeah, well, people think they're doing that, but they're not actually doing it.
Mm-hmm.
For example, when you compare two graduate record exam scores from different years, you assume that if you got a 600 last year and a 650 this year, that you got better. It's not necessarily so. It depends on how successful ETS's equating of those 2 years has been. Sometimes it's more successful than others.
In fact, I had two scores. I had a 95 when I was compared with women when I was in science.
Yeah.
When I was compared with men, it was 75.
Yes, so the question is, how much science do you know? It's not answered by that.
What we need to know is which questions in science do you know the answers to and which don't you? What topics in science have you mastered and how well? Then we'll know, then it won't matter where you are among the men and the women. Then we'll know what to teach you and what to expect you to be able to do. And that's really much more important than knowing your state, your standing in some opportune sample of like or unlike people, which is the way the standardized scores are now built.
So except for allowing me entrance into the university.
Well, but again, those decisions are made in an uninformed way, because I've heard discussions where two students, one at 620 and one at 600, the one at 620 is preferred as though 620 was really more than 600, but the standard error of those measures is about 50 points. So 620 and 600 are virtually the same thing.
That's another area question we need to get into. When we begin to look at the matrices that microscale produces, we have a standard error.
Yes.
So that when we look at our scores, we'll be able to tell which ones are...
Well, what the standard error of the measure does is tell you how precise the measure is. It tells you how sharp it is, how well you know it. When you weigh yourself on a scale, you may get your weight to within a couple pounds, bathroom scale. So you say, well, I weigh 136 plus or minus a couple of pounds, which is to say you believe that the scale is accurate, that accurate. But if somebody says, well, what's your weight to the nearest ounce? You'll say, I don't know to the nearest ounce. I don't have that good a scale. But your scale is good enough to get you within a couple pounds. And so if the difference is between 135 and 145, you can tell which one you're nearer.
So when we use standard error when we're trying to decide if one student is more able than another, within that range, we shouldn't be able to, we can't say.
Well, you want to see how many standard errors of the measures they are apart. If they're only a standard error apart, then it would be unwise to put a lot of weight on one being more able than the other, since in a remeasure they could easily reverse their position. But if they're 4 or 5 standard errors apart, that implies that even if you measure them again, that one who's more able is going to still be more able.
It would be fun to look at that matrix.
This particular explanation will be technical, but it will be complete. And if you follow it, you will have in your possession the fundamental mathematical scheme which makes microscale do the job we want it to do. In order to get ready for the explanation, we have to remind ourselves of what it is that we are going to use microscale for. And to help lay this out in our mind's eye, I've drawn two pictures up there on the chart, and I'm going to talk about those two pictures first. Those pictures tell a story about the nature of measurement and the making of variables. This line stands for the variable, and it reminds me that a variable is something that increases in some one direction and decreases in the other, and that can be pictured as a line along which we're measuring off some kind of equal units. So that's a picture of a variable. Now, of course, a variable does not exist in the abstract. A variable has a meaning of some kind, a name, a substance, a topic. The definition of the variable depends on the items or questions or agents used to reveal it. If we want to reveal the variable of weight, we use mechanical devices called scales on which we step in order to see how much we weigh. If the variable is length, we use sticks marked off in units as our reference items. If the variable is a competence in mathematics, then these items would be questions about mathematics, arithmetic questions if it's elementary mathematics. These easy items here might be questions about addition, and somewhat harder items might be questions about subtraction, then questions about multiplication, then division, then perhaps fractions, and so on and so forth. The point is that we would not know what the variable was unless we knew which items defined it and where they were along the line. So we must have a collection of items here which share the underlying variable, in the case of my last example, arithmetic, but which differ in where they are on that variable, so that the way they stretch out tells us what the variable is, defines the variable in an operational form. Now,
Of course, the reason we're taking the trouble to define this variable is because we want to measure some children. We want to find out where a child is on this line, and where he has to go still, and where he's been. If we can measure this particular person, who we've given the short name of N to, person N, measure them to be here, then we know that they have mastered this material, but they have not yet mastered this material. We don't need to teach them this anymore. We might want to review this with them. This is the material where they're now ready to be taught, and we're wasting our time if we give them this because they're not ready for it. After we teach them, we may find that they have, that their second measure is up here. That would be the second measure of that person. Then this distance would be how much they had grown between the two times. So this distance would measure the amount they learned, the effectiveness of our teaching, and so on and so forth. Now, we can't go on into further discussion of the use, the psychological or scientific use, of defined variables and measures on them. That's in another segment of our story. But this is the background, and this is what microscale builds for you. It takes data and builds up a definition of a variable and a set of measures for the children who provided the data. In particular, it does this by asking each child, in this case child N, to try out item I and produce a response. And the response is a count of how many steps forward or upward towards perfection in the item the child has succeeded in traveling. The usual item in a school test is just a right-wrong item. So we would only have one step, and we would count the right answer as one, the wrong answer as zero. But we might grade an item in terms of partial credit, going all the way up to full credit at, say, five, if this were five. And then we would have one, two, three, four, five. We would be counting the steps through the ordered levels of credit or success on the item from the bottom at zero, up one step, up two, up three, up four, to the top. So we could record when the child meets the item, not just a zero for a wrong answer and a one for a right answer, but some kind of partial credit all the way from a completely wrong answer to a completely right answer. The only requirement is that the meaning of these steps to us is forward on our variable. There must be no doubt in our mind that this is better than that along this line, this is better than that along this line, and that's better than the one just before it. Now, this picture tells us something. Up here we have our intentions. Here we have the experience we can have. This is the data here. We collect this data by bringing children and items together. And from this data, we develop an inference about where the children are and where the items are. And it's the connection between the data and the inference that microscale masters. Microscale performs this connection for us. It takes this and makes these. And now, what I'm going to turn to is to tell you how it does that. And in order to tell you that story, I have to bring forward for us both to look at the mathematical model, the recipe, the transformation function which takes the data and transforms it into item calibrations along the variable calibration and children measures. These are measures, these are calibrations. Now, here we go to our first picture. At this point, we're going to step up in the technical demands and have to be more abstract in the way we think about the problem. I'm imagining now that this response X, which can take on various values, 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on, I'm going to pick some two of those values, and I'm going to call them K minus 1 and K. So this might be 2 and 3, or 3 and 4, or 0 and 1. It doesn't matter for this story which pair it is. It's just an adjacent pair. And I'm going to consider just the step from the lower of the adjacent pair to the upper. And this is the response format that I'm using to observe what the children are doing. This symbol right here, PNIK minus 1, that's the probability that child N on item I will be in this position, will be at this response value. PNIK is the probability that the child will be one more response value up. So these are just two of the probabilities, and they're just applied to these two adjacent categories because they refer to the step of going from k minus 1 to k. Now, it is necessary, in order to construct a measuring system, it is necessary that the probability of making this step, as represented by these two probabilities, must be a function of the difference between the child's ability and the item's difficulty. And here this item has got two subscripts. This is item I, step K. So this is step K in item I. This whole thing is item I. This is the response opportunity in item I, the ordered response categories from worst to best. We're taking any adjacent pair, call them K minus 1 and K. We're going to consider what must govern whether a child stays here or goes there. And we are going to assert that to have measurement, this step must be governed by the difference between the child's ability and the step's difficulty. If the child is more able than the step is difficult, we would expect him most likely to take the step, and this will be bigger than that. If the child is not as able as the step, if he's a low number like 10 and the step is a high number like 50, so the difference is minus 40, he's way down below the step, then we would expect this probability to be big and that one small. So we are going to observe how children behave with respect to steps between items. We're going to estimate these probabilities from looking at the frequency with which children fall here and fall there. We're going to use those observed frequencies to infer these two, this measure and this calibration, and these are our measuring system, MS for measuring system. And these will come from our data. All right. Now, in order to use this to get that, the relationship between what we want and what we can observe must take this form. And this is the model. This recipe for going from what you can observe to what you want to know, if you observe it, you go this way. If you infer from this what the data must look like, you go the other direction. This formula is not drawn out of midair. It is a deduction. It follows from saying what we want to do. And the fundamental parts of that statement are as follows. First, we have recognized that all we can observe is whether a person is more or less than some reference point. We can observe how many steps they take. We can count the number of steps they take. That's the most we can observe. We want to turn those counts into amounts. The amounts we turn them into must be such amounts as can be set out on a line with a fixed unit. The process by which we turn the observed counts into the inferred measures must be a process which maintains the unit along here, regardless of how many people there are, or how many items there are, or where the people are, or where the items are. It must be independent of the particulars of the people we use and the items we use. It must be objective. It must be general. That requirement of generality, plus the requirement that the line must maintain a unit, plus the recognition that all we can observe is how many steps a person is taking, those three requirements cause this to be the recipe for connecting data with what we would like to know about the data. This, in turn, can be elaborated into a fancier model, and this is the core of the model, the nucleus, the main idea. But here is what this becomes when we make a probability for each step. Person in, item I, step K, and these K's now go all the way from the first step, from 0 to 1, up to the last step, which is from the next to last category to the last category. So the range of K is over all the steps. And here we see that this formula says that the probability of a particular person being on a particular item, being in a particular category, as a matter of fact, this K goes from 0. I made a mistake there, you see, because he could be at 0, too. So this is the probability of being in any of the M plus 1 categories. That's the exponential function. That's e to this exponent, the sum from j equals 0 to the step we're talking about, of the differences between the person's ability and the difficulties of all those steps leading up to K. That function on top of, divided by, scaled by, the sum of all possible values that could go here. Here the range, this is just the value for the pieces that go from 0 up to where the child is, k. This is the same, this piece here is exactly the same as that piece. That piece right in there is identical to this piece. But then I've added it over all the possible values of k. And so this is a scaling factor which makes the set of these probabilities add up to 1. Because the way we're playing this game, the child must be in one of the categories. Therefore, the probabilities of each of them, and he can only be in one. So the probability of each of them has to add up overall to 1, since they're exclusive and exhaustive. And therefore, we have to have a scaling factor to divide this by, which makes this have the form of a probability. Now, so this is the fancy version of the model, or the utility version. This is the meaning of the model here. This is the response form. This shows the relationship between what we want to know and can infer and what we can observe. We want to infer this from observations of that. We can observe in our data what person N does on item I with respect to the categories available. We can observe which category he falls in, and we can mark that for ourselves by telling how many steps from the bottom he has proceeded through the item. If he has a 2, it means he has passed 2 of the steps. If he has a 4, he's passed 4 steps. If he has a 1, he's only passed 1 step. Items may differ in how many steps they offer. Now, that's what we can observe. We intend to know what this value should be and with what variance. Our model that we just had on the previous page gives us an expected value for this x and a variance for this x. These are the model expectations and the model variance. And our attack on the problem of how to get from the data to the parameters, the B's and D's inside the model, our attack is going to be to bring our intentions and our observations as close together as possible. So here we have an experience, an observation. Here we have an idea or an intention. And we are going to choose values of B and D which will minimize the discrepancy between this experience and that intention. We have a residual, in other words. The residual Y and I is the difference between what we observe person N to do on item I and what we expect them to do. And our aim is to minimize this difference. We want to calculate these P and I so they come as close to the X and I's as possible. And the B's and the D's, which are the ingredients of this, the BN's and the DI's, DIK's, which go in here, are going to be chosen to minimize this difference. We also have a standardized form of this residual. This is in score units, because this is a score, this is the expected value of the score, and this is the score residual. We could standardize this by taking the same residual Y and dividing it by its standard deviation. That's the square root of its model variance. So this is a standardized form of that residual, and we're going to come back to that. When we want to evaluate how good a job we've done bringing these two together, we're going to look at the square of this and the square of this and add it up over all the items for a person and over all the people for an item, and that will give us a what is sometimes called a fit statistic for the quality of our ability to fit these P's to these X's and hence to make this standardized residual have a nice natural variation in value. Now, but you should be asking yourself, where do we get P and Q? Because on the other side, what we had defined was not P and Q, but P and IK. So here we have formulas for taking the model on the previous page and using it to calculate the expected value of X and the variance of X. And all this says is we take the probability that the person N on item I is in category K, we multiply by the value of the category, and we add up. And that's the expected value of the observed X, expected according to the model. So we're putting the model to work here. We can also get the expected square. See, here we have the probability again, but now the value of the category squared. And this is the expected value of the square of the observation from an origin of zero, if we want to take it from an origin of p of this, we'll subtract that squared from it. So this is the variance of the observation. This is the expected value of the observation. These are brought together to produce this score residual and this standardized residual. And these are now the things we're going to work with, especially that one. So that's that story. Now we turn the page to find out how we're going to do that. Oh, there is one other detail that I have to have. We have to deal with. That the page I just went over there is very simple to follow once you see its pattern. But there is another situation which we have to confront, because we have talked about item I having a difficulty, and then for the step in item I having a difficulty. So item I has several difficulties depending on which step we're on. I'm going to draw the response format for one such item. There's item I. That's the first step, that's the second step, that's the third step. So there's going to be DI1, DI2, DI3. So we have to figure out where we're going to get those three difficulties from. And one simple approach is to try out the idea that the difficulty of an item step is a function of something that's common to the item and something that's common to the step, regardless of which item it is. So this is the model, this is the rating scale model, and what it's saying is that what makes these steps difficult is something characteristic of the way you're asking the question. It doesn't really matter which question it is. That the response format has the same difficulty structure regardless of what I is. Now, in some problems, that isn't true, and we cannot use this. Instead, we have to have a set of separate difficulties special for each item. When we work with the step structure of the item in this fashion, we call it scale. When we work in this fashion, we call it credit, because we're allowing a different structure of partial credit for each item, whereas here we are requiring all items to share the same step structure as you might expect an ordinary rating scale to cause people to do, where the response format is something like disagree very much, disagree, agree, strongly agree, and that response format is offered for every one of the questions. So it's not unreasonable to think that the structure of that response format has an identity which persists through the questions and through the persons who take the questionnaire, and then these FKs are those step difficulties. We would call those the step difficulties, and these the item difficulties. And this, of course, is the item step difficulty. In scale, the step difficulties are the same for all items, and the item difficulties are independent of the steps. In credit, every item has its own unique set of step difficulties. Now, in order to deal with that problem, we must consider, in order to get the step structure, whether it's in this form or that form, we must consider what happens. And here we have defined a new variable. This is a 0-1 variable, which takes the value 0 except when xni equals that category. So if a person's response x is 3, then we could look at these things and they would look like this. He's not here, that's a 0. He's not here, that's a 1. He's not here, that's a 2. He is here. If his response were 1, his set of x's would look like this, that, that, that. So this is a new kind of representation of our data, which just marks which category the person chose. And we have a set of ones and zeros for every step from j equals 0 up to the full number of, for every category from j equals 0 up to the full number of categories. This is another kind of observation. We observe this. We observe which category the person is in. Now we can get a residual from that, because we can calculate an expectation for that and subtract it from the observation, and we can get a standardized residual by dividing that score residual by its modeled standard deviation, the variance to the root. And in order to do that, we need to know what these two values are. Now this is the model itself. That's the value PNIK that we got on an earlier page, and I won't go back to that now. This is something new we have to define, and we can see what it is. It's the product of two probabilities. This is all the probabilities up to where the person is. see J minus 1, up to but before where the person is. This is all the probabilities from where he is on. So in this case, I'm going to use my other color here and have a little sip of apple juice. Here's to your health. In this case, we're going to, this piece is there, and this piece is there. In this case, this piece is here, and this piece is there. So you can see how we've split the possibilities into two parts, and we have the product of those two probabilities. And that is the model variance for this kind of a variable, for this way of representing what's happened. Now, with those ingredients, we can now work out what will be my last sheet. You see, nothing comes after this, so we may go back and look at some of the other pieces afterwards if we want to. Measures, standard errors. Fit statistics, two kinds we have to explain. Children or persons in general, items and steps. Remember this YNI. That was the score residual. That was the difference between what we observed and what we expected. This is the sum of those differences over all the items that this person took. And this is the sum of the variances that apply to those items. Those are the QNIs we had on the earlier page. Our aim is to make this sum zero, that is to make the score residual zero, so that this will equal that on the average. This is a circular equation by which we do that. We take any starting value, say zero. We calculate this and this by putting the B's into here and going through here. That gives us an improvement, which gives us a new one. Then we take the new one and put it back in here, correct it, and get a new improvement. So we go around and around this circle until we have made this difference zero, and then that tells us we have chosen a value of B which fits over the items the difference between these two things. It makes this average difference zero, and that will be our final value of B. And the standard error, that's an estimate of the child's measure. The standard error of that estimate is going to be this thing, square root, upside down. So this is 1 over this to the square root. That's what the minus a half means there. And it's nice to see how simple it is, because this term here comes in handy right there. Now, that's for the person. If we want to do the item, we just go the other way. For the item, we sum over the children. All the children who took that item, this is the sum of their score residuals scaled by the sum of the variances which apply to those score residuals, subtracted from the initial value, gives us a better value. Then we take this back, put it in here, get a new value here, add that to the one we had. We move this over here, put this in here, get a new correction, and come back. So we go round and around here 3 or 4 times, usually is enough, and we finally get, we reduce this to zero, which gives us a final value for our item difficulty, and we have the standard error of that estimate is right here. It's negative half of this. That's 1 over the square root of this thing. That's some of the variances. For the steps, we do the same thing. We have an initial value. We adjust it for the expected residual, scaled by the expected variance. We improve, go around and around until this difference becomes zero. We have our step value, and there is its error. Notice the similarity in this. These are identical except for the direction of the summation. And this has the same form, only since it's a step, and this is for the scale model. We're doing this. We're doing the microscale method for the scale model at the moment. So in this case, we're expecting these step values to be the same for everybody, so we sum over all the people and all the items. And this is the way we get our three estimates of positions on our variable, where the child is, where the item is, where the step is. And we get the standard errors of those three estimates. Standard error for this child estimate, standard error for this item estimate, standard error for this step estimate. Now that is the payoff, but we need to evaluate the quality of this answer. Microscale has taken our data as it appears in here, and our model as it also appears. The data comes in through X, the model comes in through P and Q. It's taken them, put them together, and extracted from the data and the model, under the guidance of the model, B, D, F, and these three S's to go with them. But there's still the question of how well the data cooperated with that intention. So we want to look at some fit analyses And there are two ways to look at them, and they are both listed here. In the case of outfit, that is a compression of a number of two ideas. It's concerned with fit, and it's very sensitive to outliers. If, in fact, a very able child has stumbled on a very easy item, that will be a very unexpected event and will have a lot of influence on outfit, because outfit will be sensitive to that outline disturbance or that outline unexpected situation. But we might argue that when we give a very smart child a very easy item, and we really believe he knows it, that then, if he gets it wrong, we will not consider that to be meaningful, but rather the result of some random interference with his performance. We may not wish to pay attention to it with quite the same intensity that these fit statistics will do. So we have another kind of fit statistic called infit. And infit means information weighted fit statistic. In this case, we have weighted the ingredients for this fit statistic by the amount of information the item-child combination provides. When a child takes an item near his ability, then he provides the most information about that item, and the item provides the most information about him. The further apart the child and the item are, the less information their encounter provides. So we can weigh how much attention we pay to what the child does by how much information there is in the encounter. Information-weighted fits, or infits for short, are here. And here we have a fit statistic for each child, in and out, a fit statistic for each item, in and out, and a fit statistic for each step, in and out. So now, this is the summary of the techniques by which we do our quality control or our validity review. Here we are checking that the data we have collected with the intention of defining a variable and measuring children on it, that data has in fact followed such an intention, cooperates with such an intention, can be used to construct a measure. If we find that the data won't do that, and that there's nothing we can do with the data to make it do that, that means that we can't construct the variable we intended to construct. It doesn't mean the model for measurement is wrong, because that would be for us to say, we're going to change our definition of a measure in order to suit these data. Were we to do that, we would be changing our definition of measurement every time we collected data. There would be no general definition. There would be no basis for communication among scientists. There would be no basis for comparing results. We would lose the very thing that science specializes in, namely the establishment of general frames of reference that all active scientists can use in their communication with themselves and with each other to build a common set of understandings of the way the world works and might be made to work. So it's very important to use, I'm going to sit down now, relax a little bit since that's our last page. It's very important to use the fit analysis to verify that the intention to construct a variable has been fulfilled to some extent, fulfilled sufficiently well to continue in our efforts to construct this particular variable and use it. Fortunately, in most enterprises, the scientists involved are sufficiently in tune with what they're trying to do, understand their material sufficiently well, so that when they write a series of questions or construct a series of instruments, which they intend to replicate a common variable, but to provide varying degrees of challenge or resistance or difficulty along that variable, when a scientist tries to do that, he succeeds to a considerable extent. Then when he then exposes persons or of the objects he wants to measure to his agents of measurement, children to his items, usually most of the children use the items the way the test constructor intended them to be used. As a result, when you apply these fit statistics to ordinary carefully collected data, you find that for the most part, the children and the items do work together. There is a variable involved, but invariably, kind of a pun, I guess, inevitably, there will be some items that are not so good and some children whose performance is not so understandable. These statistics identify that because they give you a fit statistic for every child, both in and out, and a fit statistic for every item, and a fit statistic for every step. So if When you look at your data, you have a chance through the diagnostic opportunities of these fit statistics, not only to assess the overall quality of your effort, but also to find the places, to diagnose the places where things haven't gone as well as you would like them to, and to go to those places, to think about them, to do something constructive, to improve the way you collect the data, to improve the way you write the items, to improve the way you administer the test, to improve your clerical management, because sometimes misfit is produced by clerical error, by miskeying, by misprinting, by scoring error, and so on. And in this way, to construct, not just collect, but to construct data drawn from real behavior, but constructed to lend itself to the construction of a variable. And the purpose of MicroScale is to help you do that. And the recipe by which it does is the one that I've gone over in these pages. And I hope you will review at least the displays, the 4 or 5 sheets of paper that I've gone through now. I'm hoping you'll have perhaps a copy of it in your hand that you can look at while I'm talking. And that as you go through those equations, you will try to follow the story that I've told step by step. And if you come across a step in the story which doesn't make sense to you, I hope you will tell me about it. Call me up, write me a letter, call Evelyn, call Mike, because I really do want that story to be understandable to everybody who uses MicroScale. And I believe that everybody, every scientist who has the training and the motivation to collect scientific data, I think has the educational basis to understand those steps, even though the notation may seem obscure. I think the story can be told in such a way that you can understand it. Thank you very much.